Harry Reasoner, Howard K. Smith, and Robert McNeil together on one broadcast, the first annual News and Documentary Emmy Awards.
Next, here are some familiar voices and some familiar datelines.
This is George Watson, ABC News, Belfast.
Daniel Shore, CBS News, at the Watergate.
Frank McGee, NBC News, Moscow.
Ann Kessner, ABC News, Wounded Knee, South Dakota.
David Dick, CBS News, Laurel, Maryland.
This is Pauline Frederick, NBC News, United Nations.
Peter Jennings, ABC News, the Olympic Village.
Tom Fenton, CBS News, in the Sinai Desert.
Catherine Martin, NBC News, at the Democratic Convention.
John Wilson, ABC News, in Paris.
Bill Curtis, CBS News. Managua, Nicaragua.
Jack Perkins, NBC News, Clark Air Base, the Philippines.
Sam Donaldson, ABC News, the Republican Convention.
Roger Mudd, CBS News, Capitol Hill.
Dom Gerwell, ABC News at the White House.
John Hart, CBS News, Hanoi.
This is David Brinkley, NBC News, Washington.
The 1972-73 News and Documentary Emmy Awards.
Good evening, I'm Walter Cronkite. Welcome to this first News and Documentary Emmy Awards broadcast. Before we say we hope that there'll be many more, we suggest we wait and see how this one comes out. CBS was chosen to be the host network tonight by a flip of the coin, and that also is yet to be determined whether we won or lost the flip. At any rate, that's why I'm acting as host to the other hosts this evening. Perhaps you're familiar with them. NBC newsman, anchorman, John Chancellor.
Thank you.
Robert McNeil of Impact, the National Public Affairs Center for Public. Harry Reasoner. Howard K. Smith of ABC News.
Gentlemen, I believe this is the first time that we've all appeared on the same stage together.
If the world came to an end tonight, I think they'd have to go back to newspapers to find out about it.
Well, maybe the local television news fellows would cover it. Got a great laugh out of it, I suppose.
It's not only the first time that all five of us have appeared together, or it's the first time that some of us have ever been seen from the waist down. Normally I only have my coat pressed.
Walter, I hate to complain, you're the host here, but when ABC put on the Emmy show on Sunday in Los Angeles, we produced a great, big, beautiful staircase you could walk down with a beautiful girl on your arm, and I missed that tonight.
Well, you know, I think that Don Hewitt intended to have that sort of, that whole set, as a matter of fact, moved here for a thing, but it's tied up in a lawsuit. See, they threw Don Rickles down those steps right after that show.
Our intention tonight, the comedy aside, our intention tonight is to show you some excerpts from some of the year's outstanding news and documentary broadcasts in seven categories and to announce the Emmy Awards. Now, because of the nature of the news business, some of the people who may be getting these things will be somewhere else in the world with what they feel, or more accurately, I think what their editors feel is more pressing business than what we have to conduct here tonight. And they're probably right.
You're all familiar, I'm sure, with the procedure. The nominees were chosen by a panel of Academy members and the winners by a panel of newspaper television critics. At this point, none of us up here knows who the winners are. The votes have been tabulated and safely locked away in the offices of the reliable accounting firm of Price Watergate.
We're not going to have to give you any kind of an award, are we, Walter?
I think that's been taken care of pretty well. Would it give you a big problem if I didn't?
No, not at all. But I haven't seen much of your show in the last couple of years. comes at a bad time for me.
You keep up with what's going on, right?
Well, the first award will be for documentary programs dealing with artistic, historical, or cultural subjects, and what follows are excerpts from six outstanding entries in this category.
We're talking, of course, about that bemused country boy, frontier farmer, tough and wily politician, Abraham Lincoln. I remember when Adlai Stevenson was summoned here by Harry Truman to be told that he was the Democrats' heir apparent. He was put to stay the night in this room, and Stevenson worshipped Lincoln, and he padded around the room for many hours, and he kept looking at this bed, and in the end he just couldn't do it. He just could not bed down in Lincoln's bed. So he bedded down on that sofa. The joke is that in Lincoln's day, the bed wasn't here, the sofa was.
Deep in the rainforest of the southern Philippines lives a tribe called the Tasadai. The name means people of the caves. In the days ahead, we renewed our friendship with the tribe. It was the first time in the three trips that I had a chance to get to know each of them individually. Balangan is reserved and dignified. He is the father of four boys. When we arrived, his wife, Itut, was pregnant. The youngest children are Natak, named after a favorite food, and Ilib, which means cave.
Later, preceded by her mother, Angel's sole surviving puppy emerged. She was 4 weeks younger than Havoc's pups and stunted from starvation. We named her Solo. Solo was immediately surrounded by the older puppies. In the darkness of the den, they had all been living peacefully together. Now Havoc's pups started to maul Solo. Their teeth were needle sharp. Angel tried to extricate Solo and carry her to safety.
Was Earth visited by creatures, astronauts from another planet? Fragments. But look up into the sky some clear starlit night and allow yourself the freedom to wonder.
As in all of these categories, the Academy may award no Emmy, or one Emmy, or more than one Emmy.
Well, in this case, we have awarded two. And number one of two, for America, Michael Gill, executive producer of the show. And for number two, Jane Goodall in The World of Animal Behavior, The Wild Dogs of Africa, Marshall Kwan, Hugo Van Lawick, unable to be here, Bill Travers, and James Hill, both unable to be here.
Harry, if you missed my news program in the evening, did you see any of those documentaries?
I saw several of them. I remember the Wild Dogs of Africa. I watched it with a 10-year-old boy, and I'm sure he learned something I couldn't have told him, or might not have wanted to.
I enjoyed several of the America programs with Alastair Cook. Thought they were terrific. It's amazing how often through all history the accurate observations about a nation have been made by foreigners.
Well, it was a good series, but I don't really consider Alastair Cook that much of a foreigner. He was born in England, but he's been living here something like 22 years. He isn't in our audience tonight, and I wonder where he is.
I imagine he's in England.
Boning up on his English accent, I suppose. As I understand it, Walter, we leave at this time, and Howard Smith and John Chancellor take over.
And a good idea it is.
Well, Howard, they've sent us in to save the show.
John, I like to see it as a transition from age to youth.
Do you suppose that the coach has sent us in to save the game?
Our mission here now, John, is to show you some excerpts from some of the outstanding documentary programs dealing with events or matters of current significance.
Their fathers work to make life better for their sons. They are the sons, and they do not find their lives better. They see the security for which their fathers struggled so hard as a trap for them.
I've been working there for 5 years, and it seems I can't quit.
And I like it, but it just, you know, life is too rough. And like, you know, once you start working there, you know, you can't afford to quit.
We can destroy the Soviet Union. They can destroy us. No known defense could prevent that. Those who were not killed by the nuclear blast would be exposed to firestorms, radiation, disease, contamination of our food, contamination of our water, no communications, no transportation, no police, no hospitals. We don't know what would be left.
500 pounds of marijuana could be supplied, he said, within a week. The price and details of the transaction would be discussed with that wealthy businessman from New York and witnessed by a camera hidden in a suitcase.
Rick told me about the deal, and it sounds good.
I can't remember of any loads that were less than 300 pounds, some as high as 700 pounds. That's the road going, split in the center of it, is your runway. It's a road, but we use it for a runway.
DBN-70 is an aircraft carrier. It does not yet have a name. It will be 1,090 feet long. It will weigh 95,000 tons. It will cost $1 billion. It is an immense and complex weapon. It takes 5,000 men to make it go. It is one of the most versatile and sophisticated weapons ever devised. Some say it is obsolete. The Navy says it is necessary.
Every Teamster local in the Chicago area runs its own pension plan. And it's common practice for a man to be forced to transfer from one local to another every time he changes jobs. Sometimes different groups of Teamster members working for the same company, or even in the same garage, will be in different Teamster locals. A Teamster must have 20 years of membership in one local to draw a pension. His pension rights are not portable. He cannot take them with him from one local to another. A lot of drivers don't know that until it's time for them to retire. And when they do find out, they can't understand why it should be so.
I had this horrible thing in my head that if she cried, it meant I was a terrible mother. Mm-hmm. So one day, you know, she was just crying, and I couldn't figure out what was wrong with her. And she was in this seat here, and I just hit it, and she went across the room and ended up under the couch. It didn't hurt her any, but it was, you know, Here she was, what, 2-3 weeks old, and she was just there under the couch and just crying, and I just felt, you know, God, what have I done?
Documentaries, we'll see who gets this award. It goes to The Blue Collar Trap, NBC News white paper, Fred Freed produced. And the next one goes to The Mexican Connection, CBS Report. Burton Benjamin, executive producer. And the producer, Jay McMullen, is not able to be here with us tonight, but we will mail him his Emmy, if it ever gets there. Finally, the $1 billion weapon. And now the war is over. The American military in the 70s, NBC reports, Fred Freed, producer. Again, Craig Leek, the producer, is not able to be here tonight, which may tell us something about the relations between executive producers and producers.
John, you can't help thinking what a magnificent record of our times that future generations are going to have in these documentaries. Historians writing hundreds of years after the fact are going to have a much clearer picture of what actually happened, and let's face it, they're going to have some misinterpretations by our time to correct.
Well, yes, Howard, and I don't think the specifics of any single documentary, like the ones we've seen here tonight, will mean all that much in retrospect, but I do think all of them will contribute to a picture of the times that we're living in.
There is something a little wrong with what I'm about to do now. For 27 years, Frank Stanton was the chief operating officer of the Columbia Broadcasting System. He spent a total of 38 years at CBS before his retirement 2 months ago, and here I am introducing him on his own network. Frank Stanton used his influence in a strange way by not influencing specific programs or broadcasts on his own network, and by trying to make damn sure that nobody from the outside did either. From time to time through the years, the highly competitive commercial networks have stopped fighting each other for a little while they defended their mutual interests against a common enemy. And on those occasions, it was usually Frank Stanton who led them all into battle. All of us who work in television journalism owe him a debt of gratitude. He is now chairman of the American National Red Cross. Frank Stanton. Dr. Stanton, the evening wouldn't be complete without a few thoughts from you on the subject of what we're all about, broadcast journalism.
It seems to me it is especially appropriate that at this particular point in the history of American journalism, the Academy is holding its first award ceremonies for broadcast news and documentaries. For today, perhaps more than at any other time in our history, the critical need for a free press and the people's right to know is apparent on all sides. And in the face of this need, tonight's ceremony has special significance. The disturbing events of recent months serve to bring home to all of us the basic truth that this great and extraordinary experiment in government, which we call democracy, can survive in good health if, and only if, the press remains wholly free and in equally good health. And that essential freedom must be fully shared by that part of the press to which we do honor tonight, the electronic press. If all of us, those of us here, those who are in government, and above all those who comprise the American public, remind ourselves of this essential fact of freedom for all the press, including broadcast journalism, this evening will indeed be an important one. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Stanton. It was good of you to lend your prestige to this occasion. Now it begins to look as though somebody may be unofficially auditioning a new news combination. John Chancellor and Harry Reasoner.
Some of us get to come out here only in pairs, you'll notice. I'm surprised they didn't send all five of us out here with four chairs and a piano.
That comes later, John. We'll see. This trading around actually is interesting. I remember there used to be a party game that people in the business played. If you were out on Saturday night with friends from another network, you would suggest trades. For instance, I remember someone at CBS suggested a deal with ABC. They wanted to trade Eric Severide for Howard Cosell, Frank Gifford, and a weatherman who could laugh.
Well, we'll press on. Our next awards category is a special classification for unique program and individual achievements which do not fit into any other specific category. We'll see excerpts now from three broadcasts.
The Justice Department has argued before the Supreme Court that the president has the right to abridge the flow of information whenever he deems it's in the national interest. Is that just an attack on the press? The aim is at the press, but the victim is you.
We denied or being asked to give, as a policy decision, an elite status to a certain group of people, the working press, a status that neither you nor I, as the average citizen, has. We're being asked to make a policy decision that the right of the people to learn the truth and to protect the innocent is to be subservient to the right of the press not to have to disclose the alleged secret sources of their information.
At the very end of that speech here in Austin, I think you repeated a memorable phrase that you'd used before in Congress in 65.
If courage remains our constant companion, then, my fellow Americans, I am confident we shall overcome.
Well, Mr. President, do you think that on this great, still unresolved issue of civil rights, we shall overcome?
I certainly do.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Oh, don't give a toast to the ones you love most.
Whatever happened to June and Moon? They certainly aren't writing love songs the way they used to.
And a winner in this non-categorizable category, the Advocates. Greg Harney, executive producer. Tom Burrows, Russ Morash, producer, and Peter McGee, producer, are not able to be here tonight, but I'm sure they'll get theirs. Now we have another... we have another envelope. I'm happy to announce the VD Blues. Don Fowler, producer. You know, seeing Lyndon Johnson there on that film means a little something special, I think, to me, to you, I know, because you were covering the White House during part of the Johnson administration. I know that because I was covering the White House against you during part of the Johnson administration.
And dominating me most of the time. I remember that very well because you temporarily finked out and joined the enemy camp and were part of the administration as director of the Voice of America.
Harry, I think we all should serve our country when we're called. You know, I see the next item on the agenda is a commercial. Do you see any reason in the world why you and I should introduce a commercial for CBS?
Which are not the events of the day, and which are somewhat varied in their content. We're going to show you now some excerpts from such programs.
No crisis in America today needs more truth and light than the amnesty crisis. This crisis is felt deeply by most of us. We aren't exaggerating this crisis when we say that unless we find just and humane answers to the issues raised by amnesty, this nation will continue to be torn apart and the raw wounds caused by the war in Southeast Asia will remain.
This issue of amnesty affects people at a very personal level, whether they're directly involved in it or not, and especially at a time when the first POWs were starting to come home.
If you had to design a world drug trafficking capital, you couldn't make one better than Marseille.
If you look at this old shrimp boat, Caprice Détente, you get no indication that one night, not too long ago, she was worth something like $170 million. She was putting out to sea when a customs boat hailed her to for a routine search. The customs officers naturally became suspicious when the skipper tried to jump overboard. And they did their search, and down below decks, behind a secret bulkhead, they found a half ton of pure heroin bound for the sidewalks of New York.
You were relieved. You were given a bad efficiency report.
Mm-hmm.
And you say it was your insistence on having war crimes investigated that led to your relief from command, right? I still say it. On February the 14th, 1969, Colonel Herbert says that he reported to you, first on the radio and then in your command post, the killing of captured Vietnamese by South Vietnamese police while an American advisor was looking on.
At that period, I was in the Yorkai Hotel in Honolulu, Hawaii on R&R. I did not return to Vietnam until 16 February, 2 days after this alleged incident.
I say that he was there.
And that he's lying.
If he says he wasn't there, I say he's lying.
Can you prove it?
No, I cannot.
The story of the summit talks this week, as far as the Americans are concerned at any rate, has all come from here. Studio 2, or Dva in Russian. Whether we've been beaming live on the satellite or transmitting film and videotape, it all started inside this massive television complex about 7 miles from the Kremlin. There are 20 studios here, two of them outfitted for color. This one is about 6,000 square feet. It's nearly twice the size of Studio 3K in New York, the home base of the Today program. Taking all four channels together, there are only 9 news programs a day out of Moscow, and all of them are only 5 minutes each. There's also one 30-minute program of a kind of a news magazine format, but the hard news, only 45 minutes a day.
Whatever happened to Win Tao Kee? He's alive and well and biding his political time in Saigon, and he decided to talk.
I cannot say who is the winner, but I know one thing for sure, that we are the great loser.
And remember the Black Panthers, the embodiment of anger and militants and violence? Well, today in Oakland, California, they're a new breed of cat. Take Bobby Seale. He's running for mayor.
Look, I'm asking you to join me, because we're going to have a landslide in Oakland. I'm not a hard guy to get along with.
This is Dorothy Day. She was born before the turn of the century and has lived her adult life among the wounded and poor of the earth. She's been called the most influential lay person in the history of American Catholicism, as much a symbol of Catholicism in the United States as any single individual. Such tributes annoy her, because although she has obeyed a magnificent call to help transfigure this stricken world, Dorothy Day considers herself merely a pilgrim on a lonely spiritual adventure. A pilgrim and a subversive. At 75, Dorothy Day is still a rebel.
And the winners? The poppy fields of Turkey, the heroin labs of Marseille, New York connection. 60 Minutes, Don Hewitt, executive producer. William McClure, producer. John Tiffin, producer. Phil Scheffler, producer. The Selling of Colonel Herbert, 60 Minutes. Don Hewitt, producer. Barry Lando, producer. And the third winner, 60 Minutes. Don Hewitt, producer.
He's also the producer of this show, but I think we'll have to wait till next year to see whether that gets an Emmy. There is a second award group in this category, the nominees for individuals contributing to the program, to program segments, or to series achievements. And the nominees are Morley Safer, correspondent, 60 Minutes.
Mike Wallace, correspondent, 60 Minutes. Mike Wallace, Dita Beard interview. Mike Wallace, The Selling of Colonel Herbert.
Edwin Newman, writer, segment on Today called No Contest. And Emmys are awarded to Mike Wallace, correspondent, The Selling of Colonel Herbert, 60 Minutes. It's beginning to look like a CBS fix is in here. Mike Wallace, correspondent, 60 Minutes series.
Robert, you're the only representative here from public broadcasting. Last year, the Great American Dream Machine was one of the winners in this category. Are we likely to see a return of that program or something like it before long?
Well, as a matter of fact, we've already replaced it with a true-life, action-packed suspense serial, otherwise known as the Watergate hearings. Public television is carrying those all evening in case you can't see them in the daytime. And the response from viewers has been fantastic. They can't get mad at us because we don't have any soap operas to bounce, except perhaps the Louds, and they're finished. If people keep sending money to their local stations by the thousands as they've been doing the past few days, Watergate may turn out to be the making of public television. Perhaps we... perhaps we'll call that the Great American Nightmare.
In the event that you didn't recognize it, that was a commercial for public television. Well, Robert, I can feel the hot breath on our neck. We're going to be replaced again here now by John Chancellor and Harry Reasoner. Something that doesn't require our poise and confidence, I
suppose. I think they deserve each other.
What we have now, John, is not an awards category. You can tell that because Mike Wallace is not even nominated once. but we do have something we want to show you. There's been a great deal of talk in recent years about outtakes. Outtakes is a trade term, meaning the pictures that were taken but not used and what is shown on the air.
On certain occasions, network executives, quite properly, have refused to show these outtakes to various investigatory bodies that demanded to see them. We don't want to be part this evening of any kind of a cover-up at all. So we are going to, as I've been ordered to say, rip the veil of secrecy from the cutting room floor and show you a batch of outtakes, news film which for one reason or another was never used, and perhaps tonight you'll understand why.
And so, for that corporation, this morning's action could have... Mr. Hartford also says there's a good possibility that he, with some other members of his family, may engage in a... Thanks a lot.
Legend ascribes to old New England may partly be due to the sherbet mold squeeze of New England winter weather. This view, son of a...
I'm Herbert Kaplow. On Wednesday, October 8th, I'll be in... Yes. Where is this?
This is Jay Barbary. On Wednesday, October the 8th, I'll be in... Where will I be? Grand Rapids, right?
I'm John Chancellor. On Friday, May the 9th, I'll be in... Where the hell are we going to be on Friday, May the 9th?
Find it difficult to have men that work beneath you? I think I better take that again.
Right.
Gene Fettig and Sam Bozzolari, right?
Bozzolari.
Okay, we'll start it again. No, you don't know. The two American Legion attorneys most involved in this are Sam Fettig and, do it again. The two American Legion attorneys most involved in this case are Gene Fettig and Sam Bozzolari. Right, Bozzolari. Sam Bozzolari. Do it again. The two American Legion attorneys most involved in this case are Sam Fettig, Gene Fettig and Sam Bozzolari. Bozzolari.
That somebody, you didn't give one statistic there, Mr. Douglas, that of the...
Mr. Wallace. Douglas used to sing with Kay Kaiser.
Mr. Wallace. Nino,
yes.
Do you think it'll be an easier fight with Emil Griffith this time because you know his style?
Oh, never championship of the world is easy.
Nothing is easy. Well, Griffith is a tough infighter. He likes to put his head on your chest here and go at you. How will you overcome that?
In the ring, I have a good left, a good right.
I see. So you don't worry about him coming in close?
No. What is it?
You're not concerned about him, then, about his infighting?
No. Ripetetemi la domanda dietro, via, dai.
Sono qui, insomma, sei praticamente...
Peter Jennings, ABC News, Cairo. Winding shelves, eh? You want to do another what are you doing?
CBS News, without flowers in its hair, is in San Francisco because this city has acquired the reputation of being the hippie capital of the world. I'm Harry Reasoner. We're asking whether any central idea unites this colony and other hippie colonies in other cities. Whether they have anything to tell us. Why there is so much emphasis on the use of the drug LSD in their philosophy.
You came off better than I did. At least you knew where you were going. Where was that?
I think it was certainly San Francisco. And I think it was about 65 or 66, about the height of the whole hippie phenomenon.
I thought with certain drawbacks, he looked a lot better than you did.
You didn't recognize Mike Wallace, did you?
What do you suppose he's doing now?
I don't know. The last I heard, he was working for Cosmopolitan magazine.
Do you keep prints of those longer films?
No, I don't. I think it's depressing sometimes to look back even a year. If you notice in the things we saw, the hair changes, the age changes. I have a friend who thinks that this is so much a trend in modern life, though, that sooner or later we'll spend the first half of our lives living. Second half viewing videotape replays.
Hell for broadcasters has been defined as being locked in a room listening to playbacks to everything you ever said. It's time now for another tribal dance in television, a commercial.
If the critics of television news would like more ammunition, it occurs to me, Howard, that the place for them to get it might very well be from those of us who work at it.
Walter, nobody knows better than we, or half as well as we, the stories we don't have time to cover. There's so many wonderful and fascinating people in the world, so many things we'd like to say about them, but the first thing you know, they're gone.
The following people all died in this past year. We'd like to have spent more time with them. We wish we'd been able to tell you more about them than we did before they went.
Gabriel Heater, the good news broadcaster of World War II. Cristobal Balenciaga, proclaimed the greatest dress designer of the age. Adam Clayton Powell, possessor of black power before the phrase became a slogan. Dan Blocker, television hero Hoss Cartwright of Bonanza. The Duke of Windsor, king for a year and lover for life. Oscar Levant, musician, wit, and rebel. Sir Francis Chichester, he sailed the world alone. William Boyd, Hopalong Cassidy, good guy. Frank Costello, gangland boss, bad guy. Louis S.B. Leakey, anthropologist who proved that man inhabited the earth almost 2 million years ago. Hale Boggs, Louisiana congressman lost in Alaska. Jackie Robinson, black American pioneer and Brooklyn Dodger. Mark Van Doren, man of letters. Charles Atlas, one-time 97-pound weakling into whose face nobody kicked sand. Harry S. Truman, the 33rd president of the United States. Roberto Clemente, Puerto Rican gentleman and athlete. Lyndon B. Johnson, the 36th President of the United States. Edward G. Robinson, Little Caesar, tough guy of 100 motion pictures. Pearl S. Buck, the writer of The Good Earth. T. Eugene Conner, Bull, police chief and white power symbol of Birmingham, Alabama in the early 60s. Margaret Rutherford, Oscar-winning British actress.
I think, Howard, this would be an appropriate place for those of us in the news business to note that in the recent past, 17 newsmen have been killed in the war in Indochina, and at this very late date, 24 still are missing. Death is no sadder for one man than for another, of course, no sadder for newsman than for soldier, but we all feel most deeply about the passing of those who we feel closest to, and they were indeed ours.
Walter, in America's last three wars, more reporters have been killed in relation to their numbers than soldiers have been killed in relation to their numbers. That's something to think about. Our broadcast will continue with more awards in the category of special events. To make those special awards, here's Robert McNeil again.
The next category is called special events, and that's not to be confused with the special category called special classification, which we had earlier. Some of these categories reminded me of my own filing system. Everything ends up eventually in miscellaneous. We'll award the Emmys after we look at excerpts from five special events.
Something else off the wire, a police spokesman said a squad of 38 volunteers would storm the house if a deal had not been worked out with the Arabs by the deadline. The deadline appears to us to be less than 1 minute away. And now we've gotten an official time check. It is 5 o'clock. This is the deadline. The storming, if it is going to happen, could happen at any moment. They've now said that there were 11 hostages. Two were killed in their rooms. Yesterday morning, 9 were killed at the airport tonight. They're all gone.
The senator from South Dakota and the next president of the United States, George McGovern. Thank you.
computations, if these trends continue, Mr. Nixon is expected to receive about 60% of the popular vote and not less, not fewer than 450 electoral votes and probably more than 500 electoral votes. The president now, by our projections, has been reelected.
When Jackie Robinson knocked on the door of organized baseball, it had existed for almost 100 years as unselfconsciously white as a South African tennis club. Negroes, everyone but Negroes agreed, just somehow wouldn't fit in.
Well, there were many times I thought I couldn't take it, but we also recognized that there was a great deal more involved than just whether I could take it or not. And we were always reminded that if we fail as a man, it could hurt what Mr. Rickey was trying to do.
We are honored to have the opportunity to serve our country under difficult circumstances. We are profoundly grateful to our Commander-in-Chief and to our nation for this day.
God bless America. And the program Emmy in this category is awarded to coverage of the Munich Olympic tragedy ABC special. Rue Knowledge, the executive producer, is not able to be with us this evening. Now, in addition to those awards for special events programs, there are individual awards for contributions to program achievement. Those nominees are John Chancellor, David Brinkley, Edwin Newman, Cassie Mackin, Douglas Kiker, Garrick Utley, Election 72, NBC, Jim McKay, Olympic Tragedy on ABC, Harry Reasoner and Howard K. Smith, Anchormen, ABC Election Night, David Fox, Pool Director, Apollo 17 Splashdown in the Pacific, Edwin Newman, Writer, Decision 72. Oh, you really glued this one up. The winner is Jim McKay, commentator. Coverage of the Munich Olympic tragedy, an ABC special. And now something we on public television never get to say. We'll return after this commercial message.
Ladies and gentlemen, now we're going to have a non-commercial message from the president of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences and the man who made this particular program possible, though he may yet live to regret it, Mr. Robert F. Lewin.
Tonight marks the first time in the Television Academy's 25-year history that its news and documentary awards will have been presented on their own programs. The Academy welcomes this new arrangement because it satisfies the long-held belief that broadcast journalism merits being honored on its own and separate stage, and because it's a fact that television is considered by Americans to be the most believable of all mass media and their major source of news. We hope that tonight's program will remind everyone that the breadth and scope of broadcast news, and that it will effectively combat the relentless efforts to undermine the public's confidence in the sight and sound media. The Academy is especially privileged to have this opportunity to honor the men and women in our medium whose high professional standards and dedication to their journalistic responsibilities provide a bulwark against the threats from those forces which challenge their right to probe, to question, and to reveal. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob Lewin.
You will have noticed, ladies and gentlemen, that by eliminating that long walk up long stairs for long acceptance speeches, we have also eliminated those many thank yous that people feel obliged to give. Well, many of the people who are normally thanked are those in the crafts of the industry. Instead of just thanking them, we'd like for you to meet some of them. The craft awards were announced earlier during our banquet, and here they are. For outstanding achievement in cinematography for regularly scheduled news programs and special events, an Emmy is awarded to Lawrence Pierce, coverage of the shooting of Governor Wallace, CBS Evening News of Walter Cronkite. For outstanding achievement in documentary cinematography, Emmys are awarded to Des and Jen Bartlett, The Incredible Flight of the Snow Geese. For film editing in regularly scheduled news programs and special events, the film editing team of the NBC Nightly News Series, represented by Pat Minerva. For film editing in documentaries, Les Parry, The Incredible Flight of the Snow Geese. For an individual technical craft achievement, an Emmy has been awarded to Donald Feldstein, Robert Fontana, Joe Zuckerman for animation layout of Da Vinci's art in Leonardo, To Know How to See. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to call the Klan back out here again.
You know, there's something fundamentally ridiculous about five grown men standing around giving each other and their friends awards. We knew this was true, and in an effort to alleviate the situation, we polled as many of our colleagues as we could to get some answers to at least one important question.
As a result of that poll, we're going to give out our own first, only anchor award. The anchor we're giving hasn't come yet. Actually, we haven't ordered it yet.
An anchor award, now listen carefully, to the most interesting non-elected public official with a German accent in the news this year. We have a brief film excerpt here of the only nominee.
Mr. Kissinger often resorted to sign language in his relations with the press. He waved hello or goodbye to us hundreds of times. Hi, I'm Henry. Fly me. Mostly, though, Henry shook hands.
How do you do? And shake, and shake, and shake, and say, how do you do? And shake, and state your name and business.
A handshake and a happy greeting's mighty hard to beat. So at the risk of boring you, I'm going to repeat. Remember in the future that no matter what you do, here's one way to get out of any mess you get into.
Say,
I'm an Ivor Marshall, 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 so me, I'm an Ivor Marshall, so me, the Minky Bonto.
Say, how do you do? And shake, and shake, and shake, and say, how do you do? And shake, and state your name and business.
There's no sentiment among us that we have achieved anything approaching perfection in our business. We're a long way from being perfect. What we attempted to do tonight was to award those striving for perfection. We make a lot of mistakes, We do things we ought not to do. We sometimes do not do things we should do. Oh, yes, we're a long way from being perfect. But what we will continue to do is to battle back against those who we think not just criticize us, because we can take criticism. As a matter of fact, we think we're our own best critics. A lot of that goes on right in our own shops, 10, 11, 12, 24 hours a day. But we will fight back. When our critics cross over the dividing line to the point where they threaten government intervention to try to keep us, even in our imperfect way, from telling it like it is.
Difficult year for news gatherers, but I'm less disturbed, I think, than many of my colleagues are, because I've had the unique experience of working 20 years abroad without a break. And in no other country are civic liberties as secure, or so nearly secure, as they are in this country. In Britain, the most civilized country I've known, with its Official Secrets Act, it is very hard to report honestly everything. I think, to me, it is less important that judges have put four reporters in jail for failing to reveal their confidences than the fact that those reporters have been willing to go to jail rather than break their confidences. To me, it is less important that the government has attacked our liberties than that when government did that, more than 50 members of Congress introduced bills to protect us. Overprotection. I hope they don't succeed, but it shows that we have a great deal of support, and I think that our rights are sturdy.
I'd like to pick at a couple of things you said, Walter. One, you may remember that when the phrase telling it like it is became popular, I was associated in a subsidiary capacity with you. And the editor of the CBS Evening News said, we are not going to say like it is on this broadcast. We are going to tell it such as it is, which is more dramatic. And that's one thing. And the other was that we're not entitled to self-congratulation. I was impressed from the opening tease on with what a magnificent effort broadcast journalism now makes. We have produced the best educated and the best informed mass citizenry in the history of the world. And I think one night a year, we're entitled to congratulate ourselves. And as one of the few people here who didn't get an Emmy, I can say that without And it obviously, a lot of that ability to spend the tremendous amounts of money we do to send people to the corners of the world you saw on film tonight comes about because of support of people like you in the Academy, people like Dr. Stanton, all of our three networks. I think once a year we're entitled to be proud and say we've done an extremely good job, and I say it.
We in public television have to look at this, all this heat that Walter's been talking about, a little bit differently from the rest of you. We are very much in our infancy, whereas all of you are members of august and impressive organizations with a long tradition. We are in our infancy. We can be strangled in our crib. But the idea is becoming more conventional and respectable every day because of all the pressure that's been on us, that it is inevitable that any journalistic organization funded with public funds cannot be insulated against improper official pressures. We believe still that that is not true, and that the Congress backs us up firmly in that. And I hope that recent events may make other people feel the same way.
What do you say after these four have made their speeches? It seems to me that we have had a very bad time over the past year in terms of an awful lot of things. It seems to me that we have had demonstrated to us as Americans, as politicians, newsmen, ordinary citizens, that if we appreciate the rights of the Constitution we have, we've got to work harder than perhaps we have been working to preserve those rights. There is no free lunch clause in the First Amendment that says that broadcasters or journalists can go along operating under its protection. We have to fight for that. And I think we are fighting, and I'm glad to see that more of us are doing that. I also think of the citizens of the country who need these days to fight much harder, individually and collectively, to protect the liberties we have. Thank you.
Well, that's about it. Well, it's not about it. It is it. For the News and Documentary Emmy Awards broadcast for 1972-73.
John Chancellor, NBC News, good night.
Robert McNeil, good night for NPACT, the National Public Affairs Center for Television.
Henry Reisner for ABC News, good night.
Howard J. Smith for ABC News, good night.
And that's the way it is. Tuesday, May 22nd, 1972.
Good night.
News at the Watergate.
Frank McGee, NBC News, Moscow.
M. Kestner, ABC News, Wounded Knee, South Dakota.
David Dick, CBS News, Laurel, Maryland.
This is Pauline Frederick, NBC News, United Nations.
Peter Jennings, ABC News, the Olympic Village.
Tom Fenton, CBS News, in the Sinai Desert.
Catherine Martin, NBC News, at the Democratic Convention.
John Ralston, ABC News, in Paris.
Bill Curtis, CBS News, Managua, Nicaragua.
Jack Perkins, NBC News, Clark Air Base, the Philippines.
Sam Donaldson, ABC News, the Republican Convention.
Roger Mudd, CBS News, Capitol Hill.
Dom Gerwell, ABC News at the White House.
John Hart, CBS News, Hanoi.
This is David Brinkley, NBC News, Washington.
The 1972-73 News and Documentary Emmy Awards was brought to you from New York. We wish to thank the Writers Guild of America for their cooperation.